Good morning. Please stand as you are able or join us online for the call to worship. Let us speak of mercy and justice, for these are the things suitable for our God. Let us follow the ways of mercy and justice, for they are the ways of peace and community. Let us lift up our hearts in conviction, our voices in commitments, and our praise to the Lord of peace and the God of justice, the hope and healing of humanity.
This morning, our communal song will be, I Am Thine, O Lord. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where
once again, good morning. At this time, we are going to do the prayers of the people. We'll have a mic passed around for those who are online. You can just text your prayers. For those who are in the building, you can use the mic. After your prayer for the people, I will ask you to say, God in your mercy, and And as a community, we're going to say, hear our prayers. Any prayers at this time?
I wanted to lift up one of our co-workers whose mother has had a very unfortunate health problem, and the stresses associated with that, as well as full and complete healing for Megan's mom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
In my family, we had, my extended family, we had one death, and a baby's going to be born. So, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers. Jay, check online. I'd ask that you keep my family, my maternal family, in your prayers. Cousin, well, young in age, 48, to cancer, came pretty quick, and if you've ever dealt with that, it really hurts. So, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Well, let us pray. O Lord our God, we praise and worship your holy presence in this place. We ask that you strengthen us each and every day. Strengthen those who are feeling weak at this moment. Give hope to those who are feeling hopeless at this moment. Give peace to those who are feeling the frustration of this life, this world, the trials and tribulations that they may be dealing with. We ask that you pour just the peace, the love, the joy that everyone should feel, that you continue to encourage us to go through our trials and our tribulations. We ask that you hold the students who are in school, who are coming to the end of a semester, the faculty members, and also the staff here at Phillips Theological Seminary. We pray that you fill the speaker at this time to come with a refreshing word, to give us all the hope, the encouragement that we need to go a little bit farther. We thank you for this space. We thank you for everyone who's joined here online and in person. God, continue to open up our hearts to see new ways. Continue to lead our feet to forge new paths. Continue to allow us to grab hands and hold each other when we're at our lowest and at our highest. We ask that you continue to create this space and continue to build this community to where we add life to each other, that we add encouragement to each other, that we add hope to each other. We thank you all we give you thanks and praise. Thank you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
It is my pleasure to introduce our preacher for the chapel this morning. Kind of a unique experience to introduce someone you've known since they were in high school. And I won't share any of those stories, but Reverend Colton Lott is the senior pastor of El Reno Christian Church in El Reno, Oklahoma. A native of Oklahoma, Reverend Lott was ordained in June of 2018 at his home congregation, First Christian Church, Ada, Oklahoma. He received his MDiv in 2018 from the University of Chicago Divinity School. Reverend Lott received his BA from Eureka College in 2015. In addition to serving the congregation in El Reno, he sits on the board of the Higher Education and Leadership Ministries of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ and on the Board of Trustees for the Chicago Disciples Divinity House. As you can hear, and maybe now imagine, Reverend Lott is engaged at many levels within the church, local, regional, and general. He is married to the Reverend Kelsey Cobbs. So let us welcome Reverend Lott to the pulpit for today's chapel. We're glad you're here.
Thank you all. Our scripture today is Luke 24, 36b to 48. I invite you to listen in whichever posture is best for you. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." May God add blessings to the readings of these words in every time and in every place. Would you pray with me? Holy One, remind us. Breathe fresh life into us. May these words of old be living even still. And help us bring them to life. Amen. Well, first of all, thank you for allowing an interloper like me to join you on this Tuesday. As you have undoubtedly been told from this chancel many a time, it is both a joy and an intimidation to be here. And I know a few of you socially, but mostly professionally or socio-professionally, but I'm not a Philippian, as you heard. But certainly, my life has been profoundly affected by your faculty and staff now and in the past, and especially your alumni and your alumnae. And in turn, it feels, and it is the case, that my theology, especially my childhood core embedded theology growing up as an Oklahoma disciple, was partially, maybe a little more than partially, molded by what happens here. I was a lucky kid that I inherited a faith worth carrying forward. One of the greatest privileges that I have is that I have more beloved church grandmothers than I know what to do with. Yes, is among that number, seemingly. The last time I was here was for R&R. It was good this year. Not that it's ever bad, but it certainly reminded and renewed me to meet the everyday delights and horrors that 2024 has and still will yet offer us. And I was particularly taken by Professor Scott Thuma's analysis. For those that maybe aren't weren't here or don't quite remember what I'm yet alluding to, Professor Thuma shared with us about how the pandemic really revealed what has already been true for half a century. That cruising into 2020, average worship attendance in churches had fallen from an average of 137 in 2000 to 65 in 2020. and that congregations like the one I serve, the First Christian Church in El Reno, are becoming rare and rarer still with our stable growth patterns and our 104 in average worship attendance, with our little feeding ministries and our youth group and not graded but age group specific Sunday school. I have every reason to join Mr. Thuma in his realistic assessment for the outlook of the church institutional. 6 years following my ordination, I am still the second youngest disciples clergy person in Oklahoma, ordained disciples clergy person in Oklahoma, married to the current reigning champion of that quirky title. My graduate research was about the reality of congregational death or closure. I rather like the bodily term death. And how congregations, when they close, represent real loss to communities, as if a certain kind of dialect is lost to the world and unique lessons to share with us as they go through that dying process that only they can teach. My own home congregation that nurtured and loved me so well, that split about 20 years ago for many reasons, one being a defense of women in ministry, has closed. It died too. Thankfully, before the pandemic, which would have made that choice for them when they weren't ready to have made it. And yet, what sticks out to me most from Professor Thuma's observation was about the mismatch between clergy optimism and the trends in their own congregations. I don't think he used the word delusional, but I walked away convinced that I, too, am just another man of La Mancha. Because despite it all, I do have optimism in this crusty, musty, dusty church I serve. I even have hope in my particular congregation. A congregation that too has been rocked in our post-2020 world and is ever so belatedly trying to figure out how to move forward. I'm not too worried about it. It takes twice as long to do that in a church, and we're still right on church time schedules. But this passage of Scripture, part of why I have that optimism. It's why I have unearned hope. Now, from the get-go, I just want to say, I know this is kind of a bummer of a reading. I chose the lectionary text right on the heels of the walk to Emmaus. We have this text that I share that we read today. The walk to Emmaus is beautiful with its almost mystical, perhaps universalizing presentation of what a resurrection is, what a resurrection could be. Known to Cleopas and his companion, and the breaking of the bread, be still my heart. The two return from Emmaus to Jerusalem in this passage of Scripture to relay the truth that they have found, to let the 11 and company know when suddenly Jesus zaps in again with an experience that seems more particular, so very specific, in fact, man of Nazareth. Another piece that makes it maybe a little bit of a bummer is that Jesus is not exactly known for his table manners in this scripture. And yet another is that there are much better versions of the story. You want a story of Jesus eating some fish? A post-resurrection story of gazing and groping at a gory wound? They're both better in John, which is a sentence that was not on my bingo card of words I would say at Phillips. But what redeems this passage for me, what makes it living for me today, begins with this, where when Jesus had opened their mind to the scriptures. I think the best way for me to understand that and to carry it forward is that he's placing their shared experience within this long story of God's wide mercy, God's demand for justice, and God's ceaseless love. That perhaps their particular experience is still part of that story too. That perhaps even amidst the unimaginable, we can still trace the movements of a benevolent God. But even more so, Jesus puts in this short observation, or perhaps a renaming of those huddled together, that you are witnesses I am optimistic about the church, even old, established, rural, country churches like mine. Because we are witnesses of these things too. Undoubtedly, in our post-2020 context, we too are gripped with disbelief and on our good days wonder about what's going to happen about this beloved thing we call church. It would seem as if we have lost too much, that the body is broken beyond usefulness. But perhaps we might still find joy, even in our disbelief or our wonder. On my good days, I still have joy, because I remember that I have been a witness, that I have seen new life. I'm a witness of the love that once welcomed me and holds me still. Love that I found gathered around Logos Children's Ministry and Bible studies and church camp and even worship with an old pipe organ. Love that invited me to belong. Now don't mistake me for a Pollyanna. I'm not saying that church is perfect or perfectly healed or fully healed. I affectionately will call this time as being institutional church to my pastor, the Reverend Michael Davison. I'm sure you've never heard of him, as the collapse. As old assumptions and funding models and ways of operating are just giving way faster than we can even imagine to dismantle them, it is collapsing around us. Now, some of this is a balm to the body of Christ and a gift to the world which God so loves, thanks be to God. And sometimes it is the case that this collapse brings falling structures that injure and hurt people on their way down. Both are true. But I still think that the church could be and should be, and on its best days is, the place where we can look up, look upon, even touch the wounds in the body of Christ, inspect them, take hold of them, and experience the woundedness that comes from violence or racism or exclusion or simple apathy. And I think that the church could be and should be and on its best days is still the place where a hungry body can show up and say, "Do you have anything to eat?" and still be given a simple meal of broiled fish, or at First Christian in El Reno, it's a lot of chicken nuggets for hungry high schoolers, or snack packs. And I still think that the body of Christ could be or should be and on its best days is a place where people gather semi-regularly, maybe weekly, maybe even on Sundays, sheltered by walls and sometimes even doors they have closed themselves, and still find unexpected joy when Jesus shows up again in the middle of all of them and in the midst of everyday pains and doubts and griefs. This thing that we love called the church could be, should be, and on its best day still is, a place where our minds are open to see God's long story and realize that we are part of that story. Surely includes all of us, even when we have experienced evil, even when we have been part of sin or condoned injury. And yet our story still contains resurrection. Yes, I think we too are witnesses. Philippians, I love that term. You are in the experience and vocation of opening minds to understand the scriptures and also the homiletical arts and surely spiritual care and the annals of church history and all the other ways that we study religions and religious communities. I leave you with one simple request. Please don't leave the church out just yet. Don't count us out. Even the small ones, even the rural ones, even yours. We are witnesses of these things. And if we dare to open our minds, we just might witness resurrection again.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. that makes this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, and all for love's sake became poor. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sins upon the cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sins upon the cross. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
What a privilege it has been to be with you. Are you all a stand for the benediction or a sit for the benediction? However you like to receive a benediction, I invite you to do that as you have these words of blessing to lead you out. Whether you are in confined, walled places, or whether you are in the wide open, whether you come with disbelief or wonder or even joy, whether your mind is open or maybe opening, may in all of it you see new life this week and in the days ahead, especially at the end.